Thank you all for coming. I am like, wow, extra chairs. Thank you so much. This is our third visual talk. FMVA is the organization that put on this visual talk series, and we are collaborating with the Plains Art Museum to make this series possible, and I'm really thankful for them to host us, and this has been a really great series, and I'm really happy to see it coming about. So I'm Sarah Dotsenrod. For those of you that don't know me, I see a lot of familiar faces, and thank you so much for coming out, those of you that don't know me. So for those of you that don't know me, this is kind of a quick go through of, I guess, where I am right now. So I am the vice president of FMVA, and so here's a picture of some board members. Some of them are here today at the Art Educators exhibit that we had at the Plains Art Museum. And so, I'm clicking over here now. I think. Do I have to stand in a certain spot for this? Oh, wait, clicker's right here. I'm holding the wrong thing. Sorry, guys. I have a Mac at my school, if it makes myself feel any better, right? Do I have to turn it on? Do I have to click it? Okay. All right, so can we actually like dim down the lights a little bit so you guys can see photos? Okay, so I'm also an art teacher. This is a picture that was taken a couple weeks ago out at Northern Cass, and Alisa, she's actually here today, she is a airbrush artist. She came out and showed my students how to do airbrushing for a tattoo unit that we were doing. They got to do either henna or airbrush at the end, and Brian there is giving me an airbrush tattoo that he actually designed and made a stencil for and did everything himself. And then I am also a local artist. I paint, I draw. Not only did I get an art ed degree, I got a degree in drawing at MSUM. And so I don't create a lot or as much as I feel sometimes that I should. But when I do, I'm putting artwork in, FMVA shows and supporting the organization that I am a part of. And so I could be telling you all these wonderful things about me, but I really think of what tells a person's character is what other people say about them. And so these are some passages and things from past students that I've had. And I think by reading them and hearing from other people, you get to know me a little bit more. And so these will be kind of scattered throughout the presentation. And I'm not going to read them to you. You can read to yourself. My students hate it when I read off slides to them, so I'm not going to do that to you guys either. And so it's also because of these students and the feedback that I've gotten from them that I felt the need to talk about my story and about myself a little bit more, because it feels like they are getting out a lot of what I am doing with them. And so that's part of it. And then also going to the TEDx talk on purpose and hearing all the inspirational stories and people that are getting motivated about the things that they're passionate about and making things happen. And it really connected with me. And I was like, why am I not doing more things to get out in the community making things happen? And so this is kind of the first step or a result of those things. So I was not always as motivated and into art and things as I am now. I am a farm girl at heart. Grew up on a small family farm in Winemere, and went around with my dad hunting in the winters. He's a farmer, and so this is an earlier picture of me. One thing about small towns, I love them. They're great. You have that small community feel to them, but one thing that was problematic for me is that I did not have an art program. I never had art in high school, junior high, elementary. We maybe got the craft stuff of gluing cotton balls to make snowmen. And I'm sorry, as an art teacher, that is not art. That is a craft. And I'm going to stop there. We could go into arguments about that. But for me, as a high school student, this is me in a junior in high school. I was dealing with a lot of stuff. I felt like I did not fit in. I did not like country music, Abercrombie and Fitch clothing. I did not feel like I fit into the small town mentality, and there wasn't a lot of ways for me to connect with my community because I felt like I didn't belong. And so I started getting into a lot of trouble. I was rebellious, I got into a lot of legal trouble. I didn't have outlets. I was smart, I got straight A's, but in that school system too, getting straight A's and being smart, I realized was I didn't have to read my textbooks. I could scan the text, I could find those main words and define them and memorize them and do well on tests and forget everything that I was taught the next day, and I was given an A. And because of that and figuring out the system and working the system, I didn't really learn much in high school. I didn't really feel a connect to, you know, what are you going to be when you grow up? If it's like learning how to memorize things and sitting at a desk and pretending that you're happy, I don't really care to think about stuff like that. I had no idea what I was going to do when I graduated high school, except for that I needed to take an art class. And part of the reason why I was as troubled in things as I was, my mother was battling breast cancer since I was in junior high. And I had music, I had speech and things, but again, it wasn't really centered on yourself and your ideas and your opinions. And with art, I realized that's a great way to do it. And so, I mean, I was always drawing. These are sketches from my high school sketchbook. Again, no art background whatsoever. And it was my English teacher that caught me actually drawing and was like, "Dotsenrod, what are you going to do when you're in college?" And I was like, "I don't know." And they're like, she's like, "Promise me that you're going to take an art class." And I was like, "Okay." Because I was that angsty teenager that was just like, "Okay." And so I found out that taking an art class was harder than I thought it was going to be. They're like, "Oh, you need to be an art major to take an art class." And I was like, "Well, okay, I'll be an art major." And they're like, "What?" I was like, "I'm undecided. It doesn't matter to me. I'll just switch it later." And they're like, "Oh, okay. Well, I guess you can do that." And so I took an art class. And I started exploring ideas and opinions and learning that you have to apply these things into these projects and you get credit for it. You're challenged to think critically and you're rewarded for those things. And I'm just like, why am I learning this now? Why am I like finding these things in college and now like realizing that, oh, this is how you learn. This is how we're supposed to be, you know, intelligent. And I started taking clay classes. I always knew I could draw. I was like, well, what can I do with clay? And I started learning that I could, you know, throw pleat sets. I was not very good at ceramics. And when I decided I was going to be in art education, I knew that I had to take more. So I'm very driven in what I do. So the peacock theme, actually, the farm that I grew up on, we raised peacocks. And they walked around like chickens and things. And so the peacock symbolism comes around a lot. But again, art allowed me to focus on things about myself and be proud about my background and what I was doing. You know, I learned how to paint finally my junior year of college. I never had really painted before. And this was like one of the first paintings that I did. And people were just like, "You didn't have art in high school?" I'm like, "No." And I felt like this was something that was for me, something that was good. And the people that I met, even like, they were more open-minded, more like accepting, more creative. And I felt like I lacked those things when I was younger. And it also got me through some tough times too. Like I said, my mom was battling with cancer. She was cancer-free for quite a while, and then it came back when I was, well, for 5 years, and then when I was back in college, it came back again. And so there was a point where, like, I felt like my life was just, like, all over the place. And so my artwork started reflecting those things. It was me passed out on my couch in my messy apartment, drawing messy. I was always really good at drawing realistic, and one semester my drawing teacher was like, "Nope. You are not drawing anything real. You have to be abstract. I want to see you draw messy." And it was actually really perfect for that point in my life. another thing that was going on in my life was I was involved in a very toxic relationship. I thought that I fell in love and I found the one, and he graduated from college and moved to Minneapolis, and I followed him out there and was living out there for a summer. And then I remember getting the call, like, my mom had gone to Rochester and they said that there's nothing that can be done for your mother. There's no more like chemo treatments or, you know, things that can be done. And I got the phone call being like, you have to come home. And I said to my boyfriend, I have to go home. And he did not understand that in a way. And so like we ended up going through a lot of really rough patches. And I used art to do that too. When you're in a toxic, abusive relationship, people can tell you that it's that way and it's you that has to find it for yourself that it is. And I found that out, you know, the hard way. I told him that, you know, this is too much. I have to focus on my family. And he's like, well, what if I move back for you? And I'm like, oh, well, it must be love then. Like, he's willing to do all those things for me. Let's just say that I went to my mother's funeral with a black eye that I received from him 2 weeks before. And it took me to that point to get out of it. But then, I mean, I learned that I had to deal, you know, with two things, was the loss of that toxic relationship and then the loss of my mother also. And this is actually watercolor. This is I call her my aunt, Nancy, but she's my mother's cousin, and they both were going through cancer at the same time. That, you know, was a lot. And with my family too, like small town, we didn't really talk a lot about things, and so we didn't have the best communications about things. And I learned that, you know, I had to be the strong one for my younger siblings, and I felt like I couldn't really show them how much I was hurting from the abusive relationship, from the loss of mom. I had to be the strong one because my dad, I felt, could not communicate with us the way that we needed to have. So I needed an escape in a way. So what I did was, this is actually, yeah, the picture of our last dad's birthday with all of us together. But it was from then that, even though I was the angsty teenager and I told myself that you're going to move away once you graduate from college, you're not going to stay here, you're going to get away from North Dakota where people don't communicate with each other how they should and they're not supportive of the arts and, you know, these people that are not like you, I told myself, I told my mom actually, I asked her when she knew she was going to die, I asked her, are you scared? And she said, no. She's like, but I'm scared for you guys. I'm scared for, like, your younger siblings. And I told her I would stay and take care of them, that she did not have to worry. And so I did. I stayed. I had a phone interview with a school in Phoenix, I remember. And then I got a call from West Fargo asking me if I wanted to teach there. And I decided I have to stay, even though I'm going to work at Subway, because it was so part-time, it was like 30%. It was like one class one semester, two classes the next semester, and I would be working at Subway the rest of the time. I was like, nope, I'm doing this, it's okay, it's fine, I promised my mom I'd do this, I'm gonna do it. And so I stayed. And I found a way to contribute to her with art, because to be honest, she was the one that supported the art parts of it, even though I was a pain in the butt when I was in high school. Like I said, legal trouble, sneaking out of the house at night, drinking and partying on the weekends, but she was still the one when I said, I want to go into art. I want to go into art education. I want to give students the possibilities that I never had. And she said, you can do it. And everyone else in my family was just like, you know, we don't have a lot of art background. We haven't had art. My dad asked me, are you sure you don't want to be a nurse? Are you sure you don't want to be a secretary? And I was like, no. And mom was the only one that said, you can do it. And so I can't write an eloquent poem, I can't even write an eloquent speech, but I can draw, I can, you know, do the art portion of it. And so I helped design her tombstone with Dakota Monument, and then also got a tattoo that my sister and I shared that I designed too. And so that was like kind of my homage to her. And since that first tattoo, it's actually kind of branched from this, and my past students that have had my tattoo unit kind of understand the story that's behind this. And if there's time at the end, if you want to know about it, you can, but it was, the first one was kind of a mistake, and then I started talking to kids about it, and you know, they realized that there was somebody else that had to deal with cancer at a young age, and it's a way that I've learned that I can bond with students. And so that's kind of how I've started talking about cancer and my mom. It was good for me. But so all this stuff going on, I was like, my sister had graduated. My youngest sister graduated from NDSU, got her dream job. My brother graduated, had a good job. I'm jumping ahead. Okay, I went out to New York after my mom passed away. Sorry, guys. jumping ahead of myself. And I had the chance to study with MSUM mates. Amanda here got to go on the New York trip too. Our painting professor went to grad school out there, and he's like, I'm gonna bring art students out to New York, and they're gonna stay out at NYU for a month and study and have studio space at the New York Academy of Arts. And at that time, you know, I was, you know, art-driven, and I needed an escape, and this was my escape, and I fell in love with the city. There was so many things to do. There was people that also had the focus on art that I did, and there were so many outlets for it. And so I fell kind of head over heels in love with that place, and it always kind of stuck with me. But so back to West Fargo. So I decided I was not going to move away, even after falling in love with New York and maybe doing the phone thing with Phoenix and going out to there to teach. So I ended up in West Fargo, and I'm so glad that I did. And I feel like everything happens for a reason, and I felt like ending up there was for a reason. For one, I got to teach with Brenda Luthi, who has been a huge mentor for me, and the students there too. So my upper level drawing students, I've always believed that art should be like for a purpose, and after seeing it like affect lives and for helping others, I was just like, I noticed that the special education students did not really get out and get to go into regular classrooms very much. And I proposed the idea to my upper level drawing students, like, why don't we do a lesson with them? Why don't we bring in the special ed students? You guys are all experts at these different things now. Like, it's time for you to like to pay it forward, and let's do some socially engaged art and do some service service projects. And the special education students made these flashcards where it had the special ed student's name, their interests, what they love to do, and like, sometimes I get really excited and I make noises. Sometimes, you know, this is regular behavior for me. And so it got students used to, you know, these different behaviors and you know, working with students that had special needs. And they, based on those flashcards, designed specially made lessons for those students and had to think about the accommodations that those students needed to be successful. And so, again, students learning, not me teaching them things. They're taking things that they already know how to do, and they have to think critically of how can I do this for another person. And, I mean, just even from some of these pictures, you can tell, like, it's engaging on both levels. That special ed students are totally engaged. The high school students that are offering the lessons and are working with these students are totally engaged. And it was a great thing. Even this student that couldn't physically work with the art materials, and he's actually usually not very active, but I remember the special ed teacher was so excited that he was smiling because that was not something that he normally did. We got him to smile, and I told the students, you guys did that. I did not do that, you did that. And I had students afterwards that was just like, Dotsenrad, why is this not a class? Like, I want to do this. And, you know, it takes a lot of work in West Fargo to make things like that happen, especially when you are an art teacher and they think that you are doing the cotton ball snowmen, you know? Like, I'm sorry, but so I was just like, I feel ya, you know, like I wish this could be a class. You know, and then that inspired me to do more projects like that. One year I was between elementary in the morning, I taught at South and Harwood in the mornings, and then I would go to West Fargo High School in the afternoons. And I was just like, gosh, there's got to be a way that my high school kids and my elementary kids can be making art together. And I collaborated with a fourth grade teacher at South, and we actually made that happen with fourth and fifth graders and my high school students. We did a project called Empty Bowls, and we raised over $3,500 for the Great Plains Food Bank. My high schoolers got bussed, my ceramics class got bussed over to South, and they taught the students, along with myself, I helped them, but how to make bowls. And so the high school students are showing them like their skill that they learned in my class. They're teaching these, the elementary students, how to do these things. And the elementary kids are super engaged because here these really tough, awesome high school kids are showing them how to do something. Of course they're engaged. And so there was like a great response from that project, and it was in the West Fargo Pioneer, and that was a really great thing. Yeah, and so just projects like that, you know, maybe we're like really uplifted in a way, but also with teaching, you see stuff like this. So, like I consider myself to get along with students really well, but some teachers are not, I guess, as nice as I am or whatever. So, you know, you think of bullies and the anti-bullying movement that's right now, and it's like students bullying each other, but I would see teachers bully students. Oh yeah. And it drove me crazy. And I even would bring it up to administration, and they're like, well, this teacher, they've been teaching for this long, they're almost, you know, at the end, they're near retirement. And it was just like, I heard a story from one of my students of their teacher calling them skunk or skunky in front of the entire class because her roots were growing out. And she was too poor to buy hair dye to touch up her roots. And he would be like, hey, skunky, you get your work in? Hey, skunky, do whatever, in front of her whole class. And so, you know, like, I was not one of those teachers. And so I struggled for a little while, like, is education the place for me? Because I'm a very sensitive person, too, in ways, and that bothers me. And it's like, can I be working with all negativity, too? And so when the opportunity came for me to move out to New York for a year, I took it. Those friends that I went to New York with back in college, some of them actually moved there. They moved to Brooklyn. And I would come out and visit them on the summers, and they were just like, you should just move out here. We will rent to you our extra room super cheap, and you can just move out here. And I was like, I can. And then this is where my siblings had graduated from their college degrees and were doing well, and I was like, well, you know, I can go now. Like, I've put in all this time, I've put in this effort, and I deserve this. I should go out to New York and let whatever happen. And so I took a sabbatical from West Fargo, and they let me take my sabbatical. I told them I was going to look for internships and do all these and take classes, which I did, and bring all these great things back to West Fargo. But in the back of my head, I was like, am I really going to come back? If I don't, well, so be it. And so I went out there with like an open mind. I actually lived out in a not so nice area of Brooklyn, which is now starting to become really nice. Everybody's moving to Brooklyn now. But you know, I'd see stuff like this. We are still here. People were getting pushed out of their housing that they'd had cheap for years and years, and because there's all these people coming in with lots of money willing to pay to live in hip Brooklyn. And to be honest, the area, you know, that I was in, as a white girl walking down the street, I was looked at as maybe one of those people. And it was not very inviting or nice, or, you know, farm girl, Fargo, coming there. But I knew what I was getting myself into. But it inspired me a lot, too, in a way. I took tons of photos. I was interested in the people that were living there and what they were doing. And so I did a lot of artwork, which was good for me out there. One of my favorite things about New York, when people are just like, what was it that was the best thing? And I was like, the subway. And if you're like, the subway? Like, it's stinky, it's gross there. But honestly, you see stuff like this on the subway. You see weird, crazy things. You see stuff like this on the subway. And she was actually, my friend Sam came out and we witnessed this together. And it gave me time to read. It gave me time to draw and sketch on the subway. Here, to get anywhere, what do you have to do? Drive. We have some public transportation, but I mean, to work, I got to read, I got to draw, I got to spend my time doing other things rather than driving every time I wanted to go somewhere, and that to me was refreshing in a way. You also got to see stuff like this in the subway, you know, and that was interesting because people's phones didn't work and people didn't even have phones that were super poor, and you would see, you know, interesting artwork, interesting thoughts from people. And I would also I got really good at taking photos on the subway, pretending that I was like playing a video game or something, and then just quick, boom, and then like, oh, going back to playing video games on my phone. And so I would get lucky and get shots like this sometimes, and they would influence, you know, paintings that I would do. And so, and then another thing about New York, though, was that even though there's so many people there, like, I would find myself really lonely in ways, because even though, like, I felt that this was a place that was more supportive of some things from me, but I felt like I couldn't relate to a lot of people, too, coming from my background and having to work hard for the things that you do, and there wasn't that same kind of mentality in a way, and that kind of bothered me. And with everybody's, like, cell phone devices, everybody was still super segregated, so I focused on those elements of it also. Other than making artwork, what did I do? I went back to teaching, but not for school systems. I actually started working with a nonprofit group that serviced the Lower East Side and the lower income families that resided there. I taught it was a Jewish nonprofit. I learned lots of things about the Jewish religion, which was also very refreshing. But a lot of these kids, their parents were working two or three different jobs to keep, you know, food on the table, and they couldn't hire babysitters, and kids were running around on the streets, and so this after-school program, they got to do yoga, they got to do karate, they got to do art, and so I got to teach art to kindergarten through fifth graders, and I think these kids were awesome. They were so outgoing, they were so starved for attention, and they were like not afraid of anything, and they would just say everything, and they loved having their photos taken, and they were fabulous, and they danced, and just the culture out there was completely different too, and so it was just refreshing there. And they, again, super proud of their artwork. Here, I almost feel like so many students are like, don't look at this. I'm like not good at drawing, I'm not whatever, and they were super excited. Oh, now it's going really fast, I'm gonna stop. But there's schools, you know, I mean, this job that I had, if I kept doing that job, I didn't know if I was gonna have a job the next year, because New York City, this was a program that was funded based on if the New York City had enough money or not. And every year they had a rally and fight to keep their program going, and people literally didn't know if they had jobs, if they got their school renewed for this program until like a week before sometimes. And I was like, I can't keep doing this kind of stuff. This isn't, you know, the stability of a job, that would be really stressful. And I started thinking how lucky I am to have the stuff that I have here in Fargo. And so that started playing in my mind. Some more of the artwork that came in, I did a project with fifth graders where they made themselves into cartoon characters. And this was like the first week. I didn't even like know them. I was like, you can pose however you want. You can be mad, you can be sad, you can be angry, whatever you want to do. And you know, they would pose for me with those photos, and they used them to make their artwork. And then I came across them like months afterwards. And after I got to know them. And I started getting like inspired by these photos, because some of them I was just like, yeah, that's totally that student's personality, and it makes sense that they pose like that. And some of them made me wonder why they posed the way that they did. And again, I don't know what time it is or where we're running on time. If you want to know the stories of some of these kids, I can come back. But I mean, when it came back to Wells Fargo asking me, are you going to come back? You know, like, we need to know. And I thought to myself, well, in order to teach in New York in the public school systems, you need to have a master's degree. I do not have a master's degree. And after working with those public school kids that I fell in love with, those were the kids that I wanted to work with. I was not going to work out in New York with private school kids, I decided. I could have got my teaching license because I had taught in North Dakota for 3 years and had my Minnesota teaching license. So technically, I could have my New York teaching license, but couldn't teach in the public schools. And so I was like, no, no. And then, you know, my family too. My uncle passed away unexpectedly, and I was out in New York, and I couldn't be there. I felt, you know, thank God I was able to be there. My dad bought me a plane ticket to come back to be with my family, and it was important for me to be there. And I was just like, if I'm out in New York when my family needs me, you know, that's more important than all those things. So it just made sense to come back. So I came back, I went to Cheyenne, where I got to meet some really amazing, talented students, and had a great year out there. We started an art club that they didn't really have active before, and you know, was able to be there with students that I felt like I could relate to. I was that angsty teenager that wanted to get out of Fargo, or not Fargo, well, of North Dakota, that felt like I didn't belong, that wanted to get away, that didn't feel understood, and I was seeing that with my students. And so I was like, if I stayed out in New York, I couldn't connect with them in the way that I could make a difference here. And so these are just some things that I would get from my sketchbooks from students. I have students sketch for 3 hours every sketchbook assignment, so an hour a week. And it's interesting, the stuff that comes to me that they share with me. And I tell them, no one is going to see it. You guys get to see it, but you know who it is. So I'm breaking my rule, I guess. But you know, it's concerning. The kids here need help. They need to have art classes where they can be expressing themselves and thinking about their lives and processing the things that they need to. Because honestly, like, I didn't know what I was going to do when I graduated high school. They are expected to know what they are doing when they get into the ninth grade. My Cheyenne students had to plan out their high school career and put down the classes they were going to take. They needed to know that. And to me, it's just like, look at what is wrong with our kids. They're stressed out. This, I don't know if you can read this or not, but it's, you know, adulthood and responsibilities, school, work, chorus, social life, and this is a coffin, you know? And this is from a ninth grader. That to me is concerning. You know, this is a student that did not hardly talk. She has a form of Asperger's, and she would talk to me through her sketchbook. And you know, and so I feel good about being back here because I feel like I'm making connections with these kids and helping the way that they could. This is from a student that has an extremely religious mother and found out that her daughter was hanging out with an openly lesbian girl and forbade her to be friends with her, to hang out with her, like would not allow it. And I would find stuff like this in her sketchbook. And so I'm really inspired by the struggles and things that our students are going through that I don't know if even sometimes their parents are really aware of. And getting their artwork out. This was the show that we put up. We were part of the West Acres show, and so having their artwork up in the mall, and at first I was like, I don't know if I want to do that. It's a lot of work, and it's kind of kitschy. And I did it, and the students were just like, yeah, I saw my artwork up in the mall. And they were like really excited about it. And I'm just like, yeah, these kids need to have more of this stuff out. It's something that they're proud of. Not every student is good at football. Not every student is good at volleyball. We need to be giving students more opportunities of finding things that they feel that they are talented in, finding those talents. And so, I mean, that's really what drives me now, is trying to get the student to come to school excited every day. I feel like art classes, again, I'm super passionate about art education, and so giving back the students something that I felt like I did not have. So, you know, even I'm feeling like a shift for me. I'm feeling good about being back here. My own work, I'm trying to do a shift too. I'm not gonna paint New York anymore. I'm not gonna dwell on New York. I wanna dwell on Fargo. I wanna dwell on here. And so my own artwork, I'm feeling a shift in. And so I guess the thing that is the next shift is FMVA in a way. And so thank you all for coming out here and supporting this event and hearing my story. Our next visual talk is actually an open panel discussion about what can FMVA do for the community, do for artists, do for, you know, like we are a nonprofit arts organization and I feel like we're not being utilized to its full potential and we want to get the community more involved. So, you know, I encourage you all to come back next month or tell friends, tell people that are interested in the arts, get them to come here next month. I want to hear of what we can do, what we can do to be better for our community. And so, yeah, that's what I feel like my next step is with this. So thank you again for all of you that came. I'm done, I made it. Yes. Okay, awesome. If anybody has any questions or comments or anything. October 23rd. Mm-hmm. October 23rd. So you'll be, a lot more of that will be coming out online, Facebook, our website, all that stuff soon if it's not already.
It's on.
Yes, it's on our website.
Oh, I just wanted to say it sounds like you're very much out of the box, and that is beautiful. And thank you for sharing your story.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'm glad that I did. I knew it was going to be hard, and there was some hard parts in it, but I did it. Yeah. Yep. Well, the peacocks, I said before, we had on our farm. The wheat is for being on the farm. The tiger lilies that are down at the bottom, my mom loved tiger lilies. And so I remember a lot of times when I was really little going into the pickup with my dad and driving around in the country and picking wild tiger lilies and bringing them to my mom. But I mean, yeah, I'll always remember, as a teacher, I knew that I could not get, you know, a full-fledged tattoo, and I would have to get a job, and no. And so when I got my tattoo, it was from a friend that was apprenticing, and I trusted them, and they were like, oh, I'm going to give you a really sweet deal, and I was like, yes. And he got off on my wingtips, and so he had to keep on going up higher to even it out, and pretty soon it got so high that I couldn't wear a t-shirt. And I was like, great, I have to wear collars every day that I teach now. That's what I get for getting a tattoo. Okay, I have to live with it now. And I did, I wore collars for a really long time, and I think one day I wore one that must have been a little too short because my student was like, Dotson, do you have a tattoo? And I was like, no I don't, and like ran away. And then I was just like, gosh, I'm gonna have to address this. I don't want them to think that it's something crazy. So the next day, I think I put a picture on it, and I was like, this is what I have, this is why I have it, it's not anything bad, I just wanted you to know. And then I had some students actually come up and talk to me about it, and was just like, my aunt actually, you know, was battling breast cancer, and you know, I started that relationship, and I was like, oh, you know, maybe I shouldn't be hiding this, maybe I should be talking about it because I can see this being a benefit. And so I started doing it more. I made that tattoo unit where I actually told my story about my mom passing away and being a poor college student that wanted a tattoo, and these were the colors that I wanted and the symbols, and I gave myself a fake name. And I told my students, okay, this is the story, you're the tattoo artist, what would you design for them? And they would come up with all these different designs and they show them to me. And I was like, these are all really good, you know, and talk about their designs. And then I would put mine up and I'd be like, this person was actually me. And this is what happened to me when I got a tattoo. And this is what I designed and taught for myself. And like the students were just like, whoa. Like I had like one student like crying. I'm like, it's okay. But so, I mean, I find, and then like the border around it now, I was just like, well, I can talk about it. My teachers know I have it. I'm not scared of having a tattoo. So, I mean, it's up to the point where, you know, it's visible. And I just, it's part of me now. And I remember I had one teacher that when I first started, oh, you have a tattoo, you regret that yet? Yeah, and I was like, no, actually I don't. It's a memorial for my mother, and I love it. I will never regret it. And they felt really bad. They felt really bad. Yeah. Any other questions? Comments? I think I made you guys stay well over the time that you're supposed to be here. No? No? Oh, wow. Oh.
Keep talking.
Okay, I'll keep, yeah.
And the painting that you did of the girl with her hands over her face.
Oh. Okay. That was Gigi. Her real name was Gerlin, but we all called her Gigi. You saw her being, you know, terrified almost, like really scared. And that to me was just like, okay, I don't know this girl, this is kind of weird. But then when I saw her picture later, because after getting to know her, she's like super outgoing. She was like asking me to help her or if I needed any help every day to set up the classroom and was like super social. And I'm just like, why? When I saw that picture, I was just like, why did she pose like that? It makes no sense. One of my coworkers came up to me and she was like, did you know that Gigi has an eating disorder? And I was like, what? Like, yeah, she's been going to the bathroom right after lunch, and I pulled her over the other day and talked to her about it. She feels like she's not fitting in with the group of girls that she wanted to. And she feels like they're like the preppy, sassy, fabulous girls, and she thinks she's overweight. And I was like, ugh. Like, it hit me. I was like, now her pose makes sense. And then I was just like, I need to paint that. And so, yeah. And I noticed stories kind of like that with a lot of those other students. And so I felt like I needed to express myself that way. Again, I don't make a lot of art, but the art that I do make, again, I feel is kind of selfish because it has to deal with my life and my stories, and they're never going to be the type of artwork that people are going to hang in their house or, you know, like want to buy commercially, but I'm okay with that.
You don't know
that. Yes, and all of the girls that she was trying to impress, like, paint a picture of me. And I'm like, no, you're not as good as Gigi. But I didn't actually say that to them, but it was like, no. Mm-hmm.
Your subway draws, is that hard to do? When they're quickly
on? Yeah, I remember when I first started, I was really bad. And they're like, honestly, like maybe 3-5 minutes. And I got to be really good at looking around for the people that were either, like, what did you notice about all those people that I was drawing? Did anybody catch anything in common with them?
Sitting down.
Passed out. People fall asleep on the subway all the time. They're like sleeping, or they're reading books, or they're like playing on their devices. So I was like always scanning to see who is like about to pass out, or who is like super into a book, and like just like start a couple different pictures at a couple different places. And then that way, if somebody got up, I could go over and start drawing somebody else that was over there. So yeah, after you started getting the best targets and learning, you know, once you know the facial proportions and everything too, that helps. And so I got to be really good at that. And I show my students and they're like, you're creepy, Dotson Ron. Like, you're a creeper. I'm just like, I just think people are interesting. It's an exercise.
Tell about the time you bandaged somebody's hand.
That I batted somebody's hand.
Oh,
I had a lot of subway experiences. I remember one day I was like on my way to work, and as an art teacher, I traveled between two different elementary schools. I had a backpack with like supplies and stuff on, and I saw somebody like holding their hand, and it was like bleeding. And I'm just like, what? And like nobody was doing anything. And I went up, and I was just like, I have paper towels in here and some Saran wrap. I was like, let's wrap that up. And he was just like, you are the nicest person that I have ever met. Like, we got on the train together, got him to wrap that up, and like, yeah, I would have experiences like that in the subway. And then to say the opposite though too, there was one day I remember people were going downstairs and a lady tripped and started to fall, and everybody dropped what they were doing and like got her up and back up and moving with the traffic again. Like, people are usually really good about taking care of each other in those situations. And I think a lot of people think like New York is not like that, but more than often I would see people helping each other than not.
Do
But yeah. Any more? I have a full water bottle. I'm good.
So the piece that you did on the subway between the man and the woman, where you're standing over her,
mm-hmm.
I'm really curious what their exchange was like, because it's a little ambiguous just looking at it. So being that you were there,
honest, I can't even tell you. But I think almost part of that is like I don't want to remember. I want people to try and guess and make up that story for themselves, because I've had some people are like, he's totally macking on her. He's met her and he's gonna ask her out on a date and he's macking on her. And some people are like, no, they know each other. And I like having a narrative or having people interacting in a scene and letting you make up the story for yourself. So yeah, I don't even remember, but it's a good thing I don't remember, I think. Yeah. Anything else? You guys have been, awesome. All these questions and stuff, too. I have such a great crowd. Thank you for coming. I think, thank you, guys. And there's more food and stuff here in the back, more water. There's free. Are you guys still open for, like, another half?
We're
up. Up until 9? So no rush. Thanks.